Okay, welcome back everyone, and welcome on behalf of the Institute for Studies of Religion to our next session of our World War I symposium today. This morning we heard a lecture from Dr. Philip Jenkins about the changing views of engagement in World War I, and this afternoon we have lectures from Barry Hankins and John Ebel on other aspects of World War I. As I mentioned this morning, if you weren't here, it is 100 years to the week of the U.S. decision to get involved in World War I, and so that's why we set up the symposium for... Is there a tornado warning going on?
An amber alert.
Okay. Now's a good time to silence your phones. I actually don't know if emergency alerts will silence in any case, but you should try. Anyway, I'm Tommy Kidd. I'm the Associate Director of the Institute for Studies of Religion. It's my pleasure to introduce Barry Hankins for this lecture. Dr. Hankins is Professor of History in the History Department and a resident fellow of the Institute for Studies of Religion, and he's also the Department Chair of the History Department. And his lecture this afternoon is based on his very recent book on Woodrow Wilson. The book is Woodrow Wilson, Ruling Elder, Spiritual President, that came out last year. And the lecture is a long way from Westminster to Versailles, Woodrow Wilson and the Aftermath of World War I. Dr. Hankins. I thought we were all supposed to go to the bomb shelter there. Sorry. Yeah, I guess we're in the bomb. We're in a good space if it comes to that. 2 years ago in this room, we held an ISR symposium on World War I, and I gave an address titled Woodrow Wilson and the Call to War. In it, I traced the religious elements in Wilson's move from strict neutrality to essentially holy war from 1914, when the war broke out, until 1917, when the U.S. entered. That talk would have worked perhaps even better today than the one I'm about to give. But as with the First World War, when I gave the first lecture, I did not know there would be a second. And furthermore, just as Woodrow Wilson thought the First World War was the war to end all wars, I thought my first lecture was the lecture to end all lectures. But apparently not, so here we are again. What I would like to do today is pick up the story of Wilson from the end of the war to post-Versailles and show how his fortunes plummeted from the most famous and revered politician in the world to a defeated and bitter man. It's really a tragic story. And in it, I want to suggest, as I do in the book, that when it comes to World War I, among other things in Wilson's career, he would have been well served had he not jettisoned almost completely his upbringing on the Westminster Confession of Faith. In particular, the Westminster Confession's emphasis on the total depravity of humankind. Reinhold Niebuhr once said, "Original sin is the only theological doctrine that can be empirically proven." I want to suggest that World War I is evidence of this, and Woodrow Wilson could not see it. The story of World War I is well known to anyone who's had a good world history course. I made it through the assassination of the Archduke this morning between 9 and 10 o'clock. The countries of Europe unknowingly start down the path to war in the Franco-Prussian conflict of 1870. The Iron Chancellor Bismarck of Prussia tricked France into war in large part to inflame nationalism in the smaller German states, leading to the unification of modern Germany. In the process, France is humiliated, left seeking allies against her new powerful enemy, as Germany is seeking allies against both Russia and its Western adversaries. The period from 1870 to 1914 then sees France enter into alliances with Britain and Russia, the Triple Entente, and Germany enter into an alliance with Austria and Italy, the Triple Alliance, with Turkey joining later. There are small wars, near wars in the early 20th century before the Triple Alliance of Germany, Austria, and Italy goes to war with the Triple Entente of France, Britain, and Russia. If that looks confusing, it's because Italy switches sides halfway through the war, just to make it interesting. In essence, what, in a nutshell, you could say has happened is that these alliances were formed to keep peace, and in the end, they allowed the smaller states of the Balkans region of Europe to drag the larger states into War. Now, we're often lured into the false belief that World War I, you see the sides there, that World War I was not that big a deal because World War II was so much larger with so many more deaths. With Hitler and the Holocaust, the necessity of the war, the clear and complete victory for the Allies, we tend to see World War II as the big one and World War I as a prelude. But I've always argued that intellectually, psychologically, and spiritually, World War I was more significant because World War I is the conflict that brought an end to the Enlightenment view of progress, at least in Europe, a little less so in the U.S. Arguing in broad strokes, as we do in world history, driving specialists in the 18th century crazy, the Enlightenment, for the first time in history, gave the West a sense of progress. The typical medieval or pre-modern worldview idealized the past. Beginning the Enlightenment, thinkers idealized the future. The future would see improvement, perhaps perfection, in many areas: science, medicine, statecraft, development of democratic institutions, and even human nature. As I put it in my world history course, the Enlightenment or modern worldview was, in a nutshell, reason applied to nature via the scientific method brings progress. And where did this idea of progress die? In Flanders Field, and the Somme, and the Marne, and Verdun. Just pause and look at these. In an era, in a generation that thought war would cease and that we were on the cusp of a sort of new world order, making these sorts of things obsolete, remnants of the past, we have Verdun with 700,000 casualties so the Germans can advance 4 miles. At the Somme, probably 1 million casualties. The cemetery at the Somme is an interesting sort of site with a Jewish, Christian, and Muslim, Ottoman, Turkish, no doubt, graveside side by side there at the Somme. Indeed, as Lord Grey put it during the summer of 1914, in the wake of the assassination of the Archduke Ferdinand, as Germany and Austria maneuvered into position, and Russia said it would back Serbia to the hilt, and France and Britain backed Russia, the lamps are going out all over Europe. We shall not see them lit again in our lifetime. Pretty prophetic statement when you think about World War I, the interwar, and then World War II. Wilson should have seen, could have seen, could have been, perhaps, theologically prepared for this. The son, grandson, and nephew of old-school Southern Presbyterian divines, he was named for his maternal grandfather, Thomas Woodrow. You may know that Woodrow Wilson was Tommy long before he was Woodrow. An old-school, his grandfather was an old-school preacher who immigrated from England to serve in churches in the United States. Woodrow's maternal uncle, James Woodrow, became a noted Southern Presbyterian theologian, while his father, Joseph Ruggles Wilson, served his career as a preacher and seminary professor. In all of this, Wilson was raised on the Westminster Confession and the Westminster Shorter Catechism. And for our purposes today, the Westminster Clause that reads, "This corruption during this life does remain in those that are regenerated. And although it be through Christ pardoned and mortified, yet both itself and all the motions thereof are truly and properly sin." In other words, even the regenerated, those made righteous by the work of Christ, remain in sin, and all their efforts are truly and properly sin. In the 2 decades leading up to Wilson's birth in 1856, old school Presbyterians were wary of social reform movements such as temperance and abolition, in part because their view of depravity left them somewhat pessimistic about the extent to which human society could be improved, and also because they feared such interdenominational reform weakened the church's efforts to maintain sound doctrine. Old school Presbyterians, especially in the South, were something less than enthusiastic about many of the revivals because they were too human-centered. Think of Charles Finney. If you've studied the Second Great Awakening, Charles Finney and his view that revivals could be engineered through proper technique. Old schoolers wanted none of that. For them, the church should remain, should maintain sound doctrine and serve as the alternative body politic of a pardon of pardoned sinners amidst a world in rebellion against God. In addition to this sort of theology, Wilson's earliest boyhood memories were of Lincoln's election and the rumors of civil war. When the war came, one of the earliest casualties was the Presbyterian Church in the United States of America, which split North and South. The Presbyterian Church in the Confederate States of America held its formational meeting in Wilson's Augusta, Georgia church with his father presiding. In other words, Wilson experienced in childhood the spiritual as well as human ravages of war. This experience, along with his training in the depravity of human nature via the Westminster Confession, should have left him rather skeptical about reform efforts. Instead, he became America's leading progressive, leading a movement, if progressives can be called such, that believed the very opposite. By the time he became president, he hadn't so much rejected the doctrines of his youth, he merely lost interest in them. When he ran for governor of New Jersey, which in 1910, which was his first foray into politics, he had a fully developed progressive ideology. In his acceptance speech after winning the Democratic nomination for the governor of New Jersey, he said, "We are witnessing a renaissance of public spirit, a reawakening of sober public opinion, a revival of the power of the people, the beginning of an age of thoughtful reconstruction that makes our thought hark back to the great age in which democracy was set up in America." Renaissance, reawakening, revival, reconstruction all became regular themes for Wilson, the politician. And as he gave this speech, some of his supporters listened with tears running down their faces. But Renaissance, reawakening, revival, and reconstruction were all secular terms for Wilson. Or perhaps they were spiritual ideals being put into the service of secular political ends. This was in keeping with his presidency of Princeton University the previous 8 years before he ran for governor. Wilson essentially secularized the university, not because he was hostile to religion, but rather for nearly the opposite reason. His religion had become so expansive that Presbyterian doctrine, or even a profession of Christian faith on the part of the faculty, were no longer necessary. The university prepared students for service to the nation. That was good work. All good work was Christian. As he said when he ran for governor, doing these reforming things in society was the new code of doctrine. Put simply, he, like most activists and thinkers of his era, believed that his generation had turned the corner on history. All that came before should bow to modern progress. When he was inaugurated as governor, he spoke of the signs of the times and said, "The whole world has changed within the lifetime of men not yet in their 30s. Nowhere was this belief, this confidence that a new world was dawning, more visible than in his response to war and its aftermath. But Wilson had a real challenge after World War I. How does one fit the bloodiest war in all of history to that time into such a progressive narrative? How would he bring something good out of something so tragic? Indeed, it is a long way from Westminster to Versailles." As is well known, all went quiet on the Western Front on November 11, 1918. 11 months before, in January, anticipating the end of the war in his famous 14-point speech, Wilson had said, "The moral climax of this, the culminating and final war for human history, has come." Speaking of the war in such lofty terms had become Wilson's habit after U.S. entry the year before. It became the war to end all wars, as is so famous, or the war to make the world safe for democracy. Having jettisoned reform doctrine long before, Wilson was able to ascribe pure motives not just to individuals, but to the entire nation. In an otherwise sober plea to the Presbyterian Church to support the war, Wilson said, "If ever a nation purged its heart of improper motives in a war, this nation has." So much for original sin. Wilson and his second wife, Edith, sailed for Paris on December 4th. Their enthusiastic send-off included an organization called the Church Peace Union, which issued a statement dubbed by the New York Times, "Hope for a Righteous Peace." Among those who had signed the document were some of America's most influential religious figures: James Cardinal Gibbons,
Chicago Divinity School Dean Shaler Matthews, Missions Leader John R. Mott, and Secretary of the Presbyterian Board of Missions Robert E. Speer, among others. Promising to pray for the president, they also assured him that Protestants, Catholics, and Jews all supported him. But Americans were already divided over Wilson's 14 points, especially point 14, the League of Nations. As Wilson sailed to Europe, Republicans maneuvered against his grand designs, one senator even attempting to revive an obscure law from the era of George Washington that would have relieved the president of his duties while in a foreign country. You see, Wilson was the first president to leave the country while he was in office. Americans may have been divided, but not the Parisian masses. When Wilson landed in Brest on December 13th, he was greeted by the city's mayor with the words, "Long live the champion and apostle of international justice." Taken to Paris, an estimated 2 million people lined the streets as he rode in a carriage beneath a huge sign reading, "Viva Wilson." As reporter Charles Selden wrote, there were neither socialists nor royalists in that crowd, only grateful Frenchmen and Frenchwomen, happy to see the one man on whom they could concentrate their devotion and thanks for what America had done since April 1917. Or, as a French newspaper put it, Wilson represented two invincible forces, the material force which permitted the war to be won, and also the force that will sanctify the peace. Wilson was, to quote another, hailed as a messiah who had saved European civilization. After France, it was on to England, where Wilson visited his mother's childhood home and worshipped in the church his maternal grandfather had once pastored. The Brits were only slightly less enthusiastic in their praise and adulation for Wilson. But Wilson's grand design for a just peace had been weakened by his own statements after America's entry into the war. Before U.S. entry, when he called for strict neutrality, he advocated that the U.S. serve as a neutral mediator between the Allies and the Central Powers. In doing so, he treated the two sides in the war as roughly equal and spoke of the need for justice for all and punishment for none. Once he decided the U.S. must enter the war, however, Germany became singularly evil. It was as if the Westminster Confession was still operative, but just for the German political and military leaders. He repeatedly and consistently portrayed them as outliers, not only among nations, but among all humanity. The U.S., Wilson said in one speech, entered the war not only to spare the world from the German menace, but to liberate the German people themselves from their evil leaders. He called Germany this intolerable thing, a thing without conscience or honor or capacity for covenanted peace. It must be crushed. Then when it became clear the Allies would win, he reverted back to justice for all and punishment for none, and the Allies would have none of it. They preferred Wilson's middle period during the war, when Germany was the outlier nation, fully responsible for the war. Charles Selden, the same reporter who chronicled the adulation of the French masses for Wilson, also noted the different attitude among the French leaders. Their view was something like, in the words of Selden, "We are glad you are coming, Mr. President, but hope that you won't insist on our doing what we don't want to do at this peace conference." Indeed, as French Premier Georges Clemenceau allegedly said, "Moses gave us his Ten Commandments and we broke them. Wilson has 14 points. We shall see." Later, Clemenceau told Colonel House, Wilson's closest advisor, "I can talk to you. You're practical. But talking to Wilson is something like talking to Jesus Christ." So that quote right there is sort of a composite. He said about two or three different things that were close to that, and some historians massaged them up and made it a little better. The proceedings at Versailles went something like this. Again, if you've had a good world history course, you might remember. The wily Europeans, working according to Realpolitik, arrive hell-bent on punishing Germany. In addition to Clemenceau's attitude, there was David Lloyd George from Britain, whose party had just come to power with the unofficial campaign slogan, "Lock her up." I mean, hang the Kaiser, I'm sorry. As someone famously said, David Lloyd George intended to squeeze the German lemon until the pip squeaked. I'm not sure what that means, but it sounds really tough. And then there was Vittorio Orlando, the fourth of the big four, who from Italy, who was there to pick up the spoils promised in the secret Treaty of London. I'm not sure Wilson even knew this treaty existed. And that was when Italy switched sides in the war. And then there was Wilson, not with the Westminster's confessions, sober sense of depravity, which might have allowed him a more realistic perspective, but with his 14 points based on high-flying dreams of justice for all and punishment for none. The one who should have been the most prepared to deal with the depravity of world history's stupidest war and most tragic war instead arrived with unrealistic designs. Now, if I give Philip another hour, he may talk me out of my belief that World War I is history's stupidest war, but that's my current position. In addressing an audience at Guildhall in England, Wilson spoke in near revivalist terms. No such sudden and potent union of purpose has ever been witnessed in the world before, he said with reference to the League of Nations idea. Indeed, the League was the imperative yearning of the world to have all disturbing questions quieted, to have all threats against peace silenced, to have just men everywhere come together for a common object. Wilson often spoke this way. All disturbing questions will be quieted, all threats of peace silenced, men everywhere coming together for a common project. Such an effort amounted to nothing less than, in his words, the final enterprise of humanity. After compromising most of his first 13 points in order to save the League of Nations, Wilson returned to Washington, treaty literally in hand, believing he had triumphed. Instead, the story grows ever more tragic. Faced with the opposition from reservationists and irreconcilable Republicans in the Senate, Wilson decided to take his case directly to the American people. He was still the most popular man in America, as victorious wartime presidents usually are. He would go over the heads of the senators in what one of his biographers calls the most extensive presidential effort in history to educate the American people on foreign policy. The people, Wilson seemed to believe, were not corrupted by sin like Europeans and Republicans. They would see the righteousness of his cause. So he went on a whirlwind tour across the United States by train, making 40 speeches in 21 days, traveling 8,000 miles. Ever more frustrated and intransigent, he began to lash out at reporters and sometimes even his own audience. In Salt Lake City, a crowd of 13,000 at the Mormon Tabernacle misunderstood him and applauded when he spoke of the reservationist senators. And Wilson stopped and said, "Wait until you understand the meaning of it. And if you have a knife in your hand with which you intend to cut out the heart of the League Covenant, go ahead and applaud." Having gone all the way to the West Coast, the train headed back east, more speeches looming. Wilson's previous health symptoms, fatigue, headaches, cough, shortness of breath, seemed to worsen, especially when traveling at Rocky Mountain altitude. People in the entourage noticed that the left side of his face began to sag and saliva appeared in the corner of his mouth. After speaking in Pueblo, Colorado, they headed for Wichita, Kansas. Dr. Grayson, Wilson's physician, ordered the train stopped so that Wilson could get some air. The president walked an estimated 3 miles up and down the railroad tracks on Grayson's orders and even sprinted a couple of hundred yards. Back in the presidential rail car, he got worse. With the train stopped again on the outskirts of Wichita, Kansans waiting at the station for his entry, Grayson ordered the rest of the trip canceled. "I seem to have gone to pieces," Wilson replied. The train rushed back to Washington, where Wilson resumed the fight for a few weeks before suffering a stroke in early October. I should note here that this was probably Wilson's third stroke, and his medical and physiological issues may have contributed as much to his intransigence as anything else. His first stroke was in 1896, and it partially paralyzed his right arm. He had to learn to type with his left hand and write with his left hand so he could continue to write the many books that he wrote when he was a scholar before he got into politics. His second stroke came in 1906 when he was president of Princeton. His doctor ordered several months of rest, which Wilson took in England. This third stroke on October 2, 1919, during the League fight, was the type that comes on gradually owing to clotting rather than the more catastrophic brain hemorrhage. Although rarely fatal, This type of stroke carries among its consequences psychological and emotional effects that make its victims resistant to change and unable to maintain a healthy attention span. All this to say that Wilson's growing intransigence, even long before the war and Peace of Versailles, may have had these physiological dimensions as well as theological. He had probably been suffering from hardening of the arteries for 20 years by this time. In any event, 2 weeks after the stroke of October 1919, Wilson contracted a prostate infection and almost died. After being confined to a bed for a month, he got to where he could walk across the hall from his bedroom to the bathroom and be pushed about by attendants using a makeshift chair with wheels attached. He spoke with slurred speech, often degenerated into inarticulate mumbling. He was a virtual invalid for the rest of his presidency, leading to the famous rumors and some historical argument that Edith ran the executive branch, Edith, his second wife. The final year of his presidency, Wilson became the irreconcilable, refusing to compromise with even the Republican reservationists. He questioned people's motives, saying they only opposed the treaty because it was his treaty. He was quoted by his former mistress as saying during the Western swing before his stroke, That's just it. Venomous personal animosity. If I had nothing to do with the League of Nations, it would go through like that. But they all failed me. Lloyd George, Clemenceau, Orlando, all of them. It got worse. That sort of attitude got worse after the illness. In March of 1920, in a public letter, he attacked all who resisted the League, calling them nullifiers. A clear reference to pre-Civil War Southern states trying to nullify federal law. The Washington Post dubbed Wilson the affirmative irreconcilable, while one senator said aptly, as the treaty and the League died a slow death, the president strangled his own child. After the treaty was defeated, the president told Dr. Grayson, "I feel like going to bed and staying there." With the treaty unratified, Congress passed a joint resolution declaring the war officially over, and Wilson vetoed it. It was as if Wilson were living out a line from an 1889 essay he wrote titled Leaders of Men. Writing 20 years before he ever ran for political office, he spoke in this address of the difficulty intellectuals have in becoming practical leaders. "He holds a narrow commission," Wilson wrote of impractical theorists, "and his work is soon finished. He may count himself happy if he escape the misfortune of being esteemed a fanatic." After his presidency came to an end, Edith and Woodrow moved to a private residence in Washington on S Street, where Wilson spent his days as "our invalid," as Edith once referred to him. Edith's brother moved in as Wilson's secretary, while Isaac and Mary Scott served as personal attendants. Wilson intended to write another book, but never did. Writing was difficult for someone who needed Isaac Scott's assistance while shaving. He was able to dictate letters to Edith's brother, read, listen to his radio occasionally, and then engage in his favorite activity, afternoon automobile rides around the city. He eventually improved to the point where he could occasionally go to a nearby theater. The highlights of Wilson's last 3 years were when people stopped by for brief visits at the house on S Street, sometimes fairly large groups, sometimes individuals Wilson had worked with in his career. Clemenceau, for example, visited Wilson. Each Armistice Day, November 11th, now Veterans Day, the holiday parade would come down S Street and stop to honor Wilson. As was the case with other groups, Wilson would shuffle to the door, say a few words, wave, and head back into the house. Sometimes he resisted the temptation to speak for fear of the inarticulate stammering. In these instances, he would just wave and smile. But Wilson had one last national appearance to make. In October 1923, Bella Baruch, the oldest daughter of financier and political consultant Bernard Baruch, and her associate Evangeline Johnson, persuaded Wilson to give a 10-minute radio speech on the eve of Armistice Day. They were working as part of the Nonpartisan League, a group that promoted the League of Nations. As you may know, the U.S. never joined the League of Nations. They were still trying to get the U.S. to join. Preparing the speech was a physical ordeal for Wilson, and Edith tried to get him to cancel it, but he pressed on. On November 10th, Wilson gave the address from his study at the home on S Street. Broadcast trucks were set up outside to send the signal to radio stations that would blast it across the country. Stations not covering the event stayed off the air so as not to interfere with the signal. The speech was no doubt the biggest event in the roughly three-year history of radio to that time. Millions heard Wilson in places as far-flung as Georgia, Dallas, and Denver. It was the first time since leaving the White House that Wilson had broken his silence on the treaty and the League, and he took advantage of it. Going off script from the pre-released text, he once again lashed out at all who derailed his peace plan, calling U.S. actions since the war deeply ignoble, cowardly, and dishonorable. The following morning, Armistice Day, a crowd of 20,000 gathered at DuPont Circle for the Washington Parade. Led by Virginia Senator and former Wilson administration official Carter Glass, the crowd, including a marching band, headed for the Wilson home. The former president shuffled out for the perfunctory greeting. These were his people, those who, like Bella Baruch and Evangeline Johnson and the Nonpartisan League, supported Wilson's internationalist vision and still hoped the U.S. might someday join the League. After Senator Glass gave his speech, Wilson mustered about 2 minutes of his own, bent over with tears streaming down his face. At one point, his voice faltered. The band thought he had concluded and struck up a hymn, "How Firm a Foundation." Wilson raised his hand, signaling he wasn't through, and the band cut it off very awkwardly. Wilson then concluded, "I am not one of those that have the least anxiety about the triumph of the principles I have stood for. I have seen fools resist providence before, and I have seen their destruction, as will come upon these again, utter destruction and attempt. That we shall prevail is as sure as that God reigns." When he finished, the band struck up "Onward Christian Soldiers" and followed with "Dixie." This would be the last time he appeared in public. As Edith recounted the occasion later, he turned and moved slowly back into the house, and thus ended the long crusade. Wilson died in February, 3 months later. As one would expect, there were multiple memorials for Wilson. The one at Wilson's own Central Presbyterian Church was reserved for Sunday, February 10th. His pastor, the Reverend James H. Taylor, preached a sermon entitled, "A Great Man Has Fallen." Citing Wilson's prodigious intellect, Taylor called the former president a prophet and a seer who embodied great moral purpose, spiritual idealism, love for humanity, disinterested righteousness, a vision of service, lofty idealism, hope, joy, and love. Then Taylor said something that was more revealing than he probably intended. He said, "Wilson's religious convictions were very clear and strong. He believed in the spirituality of religion." The spirituality of religion. Taylor no doubt meant this as a compliment, but instead I think it encapsulates precisely where Wilson's religion went wrong. Wilson had almost completely spiritualized his Reformed Presbyterian heritage. At Versailles, as elsewhere, he lived out half of that heritage. He retained the theological idea that there were forces of good and evil at war with each other on this planet. But he had become too precise about where each force could be located. He stood with the forces of righteousness while his European rivals did the bidding of darkness. He had forgotten almost completely the Westminster Confession's admonition that evil resides in all of humanity all the time. This corruption of nature during this life does remain in those that are regenerated, and although it be through Christ pardoned and mortified, yet both itself and all the motions thereof are truly and properly sin. For Wilson, as for most progressives, darkness was associated with what was old. At Versailles, the old consisted of the Europeans, Clemenceau, David Lloyd George. Righteousness resided in the new world of America, which would lead humanity into a new era of justice and peace. Wilson's optimism concerning the power of humankind to do good hailed not from his Reformed heritage, but from liberal theology, the social gospel, progressivism, and ultimately the romantic spiritualization of religion, to the point that it existed everywhere and therefore nowhere. When some years later, H. Richard Niebuhr characterized theological liberalism, he might almost have been characterizing Wilson's religion. Niebuhr wrote, "A God without wrath brought men without sin into a kingdom without judgment through the ministrations of a Christ without a cross." Wilson's theology retained wrath, sin, and judgment, but only for those who resisted the inevitable progress of modernity. Like most, Wilson was a man of his times, living in an era that had largely lost a sense that the ways of man can never be the ways of God, that while we pray for the coming of God's kingdom, it will never come fully with human effort alone. Wilson was a man of his times. Thank you. We do dialogue now? Yes? Bob?
Would you care to comment on what might have been had Wilson not had these strokes, and then extrapolate that or extend that to the end of World War II, where you had Churchill having the little mini strokes and a sick President Roosevelt? It seems that these people, their lofty purchase saps them of strength, and medically speaking, they become ill, and as they become ill, they become less functional.
Yeah. Well, that's a better answer than I could give to your own question, Bob. And this is a medical doctor and longtime friend of mine asking that question. So, you know, to take a broader swipe at that question, when it comes to the contingencies of history, you know, with my world history class, you know, we do the five C's of history, and contingency to me is the hardest one, because it's like, well, it's not a direct cause from one thing to another, but it's if this had been different, well, this had been different. And it's always interesting and fun to speculate about those sorts of things. I've probably fallen into the camp that things could always have been different, but doggone it, they weren't. You know, they happened the way they did. How they would have been different, you know, it's really hard to say if they would have been different. I'm not even suggesting that if Wilson had maintained a healthy sort of sense of the depravity of human nature, that the events of history would have been that different. I'm not even sure I would suggest that. I do think he would have been better off. I think that he might not have been so disillusioned. And again, it could have been the hardening of the arteries as much as the disillusionment, but perhaps it would have served him better in his own ability to function as a diplomat in that setting of Versailles. It really struck me when I did this project. And by the way, I'm not an expert on World War I, and there are lots of people who spend their whole career studying Wilson. I mean, I spent 3 years studying Wilson and wrote one book on him. But what struck me, it was a religious biography, so I'm primarily interested in how religion affected him and how he both used religion and how his religion changed over time and so forth. But what really, one of the couple of things that really struck me when I did the book was, you know, just how sort of expansive religion became for him, where almost anything that is good in the sense of reform becomes a sort of religious enterprise. Therefore, we don't need doctrine anymore. And he used to say this on occasion, that the days when we need to talk about the specific doctrines of Christianity are pretty much gone. And what struck me the most about that was how easily he seemed to move into that over the course of his life. And I think he really was a man of his times in that sense. He easily transitioned out of that. I could find no evidence of any sort of deep grappling with this change. It just happened.
Would you call him a deist at this point?
I don't think he would be a deist. I wouldn't go that far. I mean, he still had, you know, firm worship practices, worshiped God, prayed through Christ, but not doctrine. He just wasn't interested in doctrine. So, yeah. Yeah.
So to what extent do you think that, you know, spiritualization of religion has to do with the fact that he's the president of a religiously diverse country? I mean, he can't just be the president of the Westminster Confession, mm-hmm. confessing Presbyterians. He has to appeal to a country that is really diverse, mm-hmm. theologically, traditionally. So, I mean, one can think of it as a kind of falling away but at the same time, it's maybe the exigencies of the job of his position that bring that on.
Yeah. It could be, but another way of looking at that is that I think it's possible to maintain a sort of doctrinally robust Christianity while also recognizing that as president, you have to speak in these broader civil religion categories. And so I think we've had presidents who have done that. I think Carter did that. I think Reagan, George W. Bush did that. Personally, their religion was still very specifically Christian and doctrinally Christian, although... You know, Reagan doesn't have a very highly developed sense of doctrine. But in their public acts as president, they recognize they're sort of moving into a different sort of religion. For Wilson, this really did become his religion, as far as I can tell. That public or private, he came to the point where spiritual things were still very important to him. Praying was important. Going to church. Reading his Bible. He wore out Bibles. People used to comment on how moving his public prayers were at chapel at Princeton. And other areas where he was asked to pray publicly. But when you read his private letters and so forth, even to Ellen, his first wife, Edith, his second wife, to other sorts of friends, he just doesn't talk that much about religion, period. And when he does, it is this sort of broad, expansive, all things are good sort of spiritualization, as I call it. So it's a good question, though. It's the exigencies of the job did push in that direction as well. Anything else?
Okay.
Thank you.